All right, thanks. So I think, like you said, right, cash is definitely the easiest way for consumers to pay. And so as we look to get consumers to transition from cash to other digital payment, the question is sort of more, what are those properties of cash, right, that make it so convenient, and how do we sort of like bring that into digital payments? I think there are sort of maybe four, maybe five things, right, that are important to think about. The first one is that cash is frictionless, right? It's super easy to transact in cash, right? And so it's the same thing for digital payment. It's super important that, you know, when consumers are actually making payment or paying their merchants, that experience is doesn't have any friction, whether that is like, you know, transaction speed, reliability, or success rates, or fraud. You know, how do you just make sure that is a seamless experience? And I think that's probably the, you know, beyond other things, that's probably one of the biggest issues today still in the space, is that, you know, payment is still, you know, really as frictionless as cash is. The second one is cost, right? You know, cash is free, or cash used to be free, right? But there's still that perception that, you know, cash is free, especially on the merchant side, right? So how do we sort of constantly think about, you know, bringing down that, you know, that cost barrier, right? To accepting digital payments, right? And I think on the consumer side, you know, cash is actually not as free anymore, right? Because today you go to an agent and you would pay, you know, anything between 2 to 5% to actually withdraw cash. You know, we always think that's a good thing because, you know, now it's pushing consumers to say cash is actually not free. And so how do you sort of like, you know, capitalize on that and also, you know, lower the cost on the merchant end as well. The third one that I think is really important is that cash is just ubiquitous, right? Everywhere, everyone understands, you know, how to transact in cash, right? Whether you're literate or not. And I think that one challenge that while there's been a lot of progress, that we haven't really cracked is what is that form factor or payment method that would really, you know, be everywhere, right? And everyone can easily transact in, right? Today, I mean, you can transact with a POS terminal or anything like that, but that's still, you know, that has its own challenges in terms of like cost. You know, it's very challenging to sort of like, you know, scale that, especially for small payments. You know, you have bank transfers which are, you know, kind of, you know, next level. You know, if you think about cards, it's, you know, everywhere. But it still suffers a bit from that friction, which is friction, right? But I think we're still, you know, a bit far away from finding that form factor that would really take off, right? And I think the fourth one is, you know, actually describing a bit of that, what's the profit story, right? To a business and to a consumer. Because the truth is that we're probably not going to fully solve one-to-one, right? You know, perfectly. And so you still need to make it that, in spite of all of this, how do we make it profitable and you can sell that story, you know, to the businesses and to the consumers to say, if you actually transact digitally, these are the benefits to you, right? You know, as a business, you can get a loan as a consumer, you know, you can do this, you know, you can get a better view of your activity, right? And I think number five, of course, is then like education, right? And just making sure that as we address, you know, 1 to 4, that we're constantly educating folks like that.
Thank you very much. So, Priya,
let's go to
the next. If you plan your merchants to very happy and your business, I want you to explain what your business is and how you are able to ensure that your merchants are able to transition from the
So,
just to give a brief introduction of Mplify, we're a Salesforce automation company that's focused on helping manufacturers in their FMCG segment drive drive efficiency, reduce the cost of sales. So for us, one of the primary driving factors is that any product you pick at a supermarket here does not have a listed price at which it's supposed to be bought by consumers, right? And so because of that, manufacturers are able to mandate maybe up to distributors what their pricing should be. And beyond that, within, you know, open markets as well as at the retail shop, they don't really have much of a decision-making power in terms of at what price that product sells, right? Which really drives, it's one of the key factors in terms of driving their sales. So how we help retailers in driving this is that the pricing that we have on the platform, which is, I mean, on the software, which is being used by the sales teams of the manufacturers, that pricing on the platform is controlled by the manufacturer. So the benefit for the retailer is having the price at which the manufacturer is selling. And, you know, if someone else comes in and sells your products, or if you go to the open market and buy, there's no sort of regulation. And you really have to go to 5-6 different shops before you can get the best price. And so using the platform for retailers, it's easy because they know they are locking the price, the best price that the manufacturer can offer them.
Cool. So chief of my comments on this. So from my lab to Korea, everyone's trying to drive this payment adoption. Would you say it's just another way for us to generate revenue, or there's an actual need for the retailer or for whoever our end user is to pay in term?
I would say, like everyone has said, if you eliminate cash, the value you unlock for that brand line for everyone is much, much bigger. Now, in the short term, the cost of eliminating cash, likely somebody will pay it. Either the customer himself, or the retailer they're buying from, or some payment service provider who says, I'm going to eliminate this cash. Somebody will swallow that cost. Now, it's whether that person who swallows that cost is well positioned to get from the value on the upside when it finally comes or not. That is the open question. But if you eliminate cash, value is unlocked for everyone, but it's not for that one, including the economy. Short term, what we're always seeing
I say I'll come back with my money to that time. There's a markup on the price of those books at that time. We are now seeing some of these wholesalers telling those retailers that actually, when my driver comes, don't give me money, don't put it in my accounts. In that entire exchange, cash out is there. But there was a credit component that was thrown in, which brings me to this completely cross the area.
Yeah, I think that for us, right, especially FMCG, one of the biggest challenges is actually cost, right? Because many of them are running the slim margins, right? And so, one, they own slim margins. Two is, you know, depending on the size, they also have to do like losses on the products. And so, you know, adding that extra cost of, you know, actually paying some of the process digital payment on their behalf, you know, tends to be challenging, right? But I think just like Opa said, you know, what we've also seen is that, you know, credit is also a very strong incentivizer, right, to actually get these folks to essentially that profit story, right? Yes, I will pay, you know, these fees, but I know that because now the visibility into my payments, I can actually now, you know, get access to credit and, you know, grow a bit of my business. I'm a bit more willing to grow. So I think that's the one biggest thing apart from, you know, all things that
I've covered. So, Priya, I believe most of your clients are businesses. What are the usual challenges for them?
So for us, the challenge is the salesperson. You know, for us, it's the salespeople who are using the application and driving these digital payments, and it's sort of like it hampers their job security, right? Because till yesterday they were the ones picking up the cash and going and giving it to the distributor, and now the payment is done directly from the customer to the distributor. So it's not just job security of what they're doing, but if there was anything in the middle that they were also making, all of that gets shut. So I think for us, the biggest challenge has been the people who are helping us to implement this, showing them really what's in it for them. Not the short-term loss, but the long-term gain that they can get.
That's
like,
don't be a
Yeah, I mean, I think that the pay on delivery sort of like conundrum, right? You know, chicken and egg, right? But the biggest thing that we're trying to solve is the trust deficit, right? And you know, in the B2C space, it was always the case of, you know, if I actually deliver this thing, you know, do I trust that it's the right product? Do I trust that it will actually come on time? You know, and so I'd rather take my risk by, you know, choosing to pay on delivery, right? I think in the B2B space, it's slightly different, right? I think that especially now with, you know, the couple of like, you know, bigger players, you know, that trust element is a little bit, what's the word? There's a bit more trust, right, you know, between the players, right, compared to your B2C, especially because it tends to be a lot of repeat orders and repeat relationships, and so there is a lot more trust compared to like your B2C players. But I think that, you know, generally, I'm a businessman. If you essentially give me the option of, you know, paying you know, 2 days after versus paying now, I would always choose the option, you know, to pay later, right? So, you know, are there innovative ways that can allow that, you know, risk to be taken away on both sides, right? You know, so, you know, merchants have wallets, for example, you know, could you have, you know, holds on the wallet where, you know, the money is still there, they can see it, but, you know, you as a business, you also know that, okay, there's actually money there, and, you know, we can actually deliver, and we can expect that, you know, we'll receive our money. Again, credit is also a strong way to drive this, right? So obviously, if you have a buy now, you know, with buy now, pay later, you ultimately force the customer to sort of like, you know, make that commitment to pay upfront, right? At least pay portion upfront, and then, you know, they can spread a number of that of those payments later. So I think that, you know.
I'll say the biggest challenge at the moment is time. It takes time to thoroughly dimension what customers like you need. It takes time to get your buy-in. It takes time to get the buy-in of the team as one vibe to create some cohesion around how should this thing even move. Then you get it started, and it takes even more time. Oh, did we think about this thing correctly? Okay, let's change it. Right. So the biggest challenge is just time. And I don't have a solution.
That we are many times at the mercy of like other other players, right? You know, I'm looking at Okoro with an imper player, right? But it's, we are essentially, you know, a bit like, you know, dependent on many players, right? Of course, it does mean that we are by nature forced to, you know, enter into many partnerships, right? Because, you know, we do need, you know, to create us, but we can't do it ourselves. But we can't go build all of the rails ourselves. And so we do need to partner with many players. But that also brings its own level of challenges, especially where you can't control your destiny. And so, you know, there have been instances where we got into partnerships and just decided that, you know what, you know, we need to own our destiny and we're just going to go, you know, fully build this ourselves. But that's not sustainable, right? You know, especially because, you know, there are more than enough problems to solve, you know, on that merchant-facing side of things, you know, without having to bother about, you know, building infrastructure. Yeah. Let me go first. So I think it's a lot of the things that we have said, right? In terms of helping and build trust. It doesn't happen, it's not gonna happen overnight, right? You need to get people to come in, you know, they will start with one transaction, two transactions, see that everything works. And then they will sort of like, you know, really continue, right? We're currently running like a little sort of, you know, pilot in the southeast, right? And we kind of see what people have done is, you know, you see that the first day the guy does like 1,000, kind of like seeing, does this thing work or does it not work? 3 days after, it's done like, you know, 100K. And then after we will So you're doing the media marketing, you get that right there. And so I think you just need to make sure that, you know, you bring them in, you find ways to bring them in, right? You know, they're bringing in, like, you know, different books, whether it's credit, whether it is even things like, you know, you don't have to move cash around and be at risk of, like, robbers, right? Because in many areas, you know, insecurity is actually one of the biggest drivers of, like, digital payment, right? The people now just are also scared of moving cash around, right? And then you bring them into those things, but to really keep them in and get them to actually start to actively transact, you do need to make sure that, you know, all the things that we've talked about, the friction is taken away, that, you know, you kind of, like, you know, manage the cost and get them to look up one day, and, you know, see that, like, you know, it's paid so much in fees, and you just sort of, like, also, you know, support is important. You know, if, what do you do when they're issues, right? It goes a long way in addressing trust, right? So if I've got an issue and it's going to take you, you know, frankly, 2 days to solve, it's too long, right? Because for many of these folks, you know, they are, like, you know, like B2B business, and if you can't solve the issues in, you know, a matter of minutes, you really lose their trust fast enough. I think I'll just echo Opa's point, right? I think, you know, the very clear, you know, upward trajectory in terms of digitization, I think, you know, payments will continue to grow. I think that the great part is that, you know, irrespective of, like, whatever the earnings on the economy is, right, you know, payment is almost kind of, like, agnostic to it, because, you know, people continue to transact, right? You know, I think that payments grow fastest in the recession, right? So, you know, kind of definitely expect that there are an upward trajectory going forward.
That's it. We hope we've been able to convince you what the future of the internet will be. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this fast spent. The second, the next session for today is called The Role of Institutions in Fostering the Startup Ecosystem. And our panel host today is Brenda from the Village Council.